Hello, I'm Dr. John Iskandar. Welcome to CDC Beyond the Data. I'm here today with Matthew Penn, a lawyer who directs CDC's Public Health Law Program. Matthew, in today's session, we heard about the power of public health law to confront emerging health issues. I wonder if you could start by reminding us, what is the basis for public health law, and at what various levels of government is this undertaken?
So that's a great question. The public health law really exists at all levels of government, including the federal level, the state level, local level, and including the tribes and the territories. So at the state and local level, the power really comes through what we call the police powers. And the police powers are really the power to help guide the health and welfare of the citizens of state and local jurisdictions. And those authorities and powers really pre-existed even the U.S. Constitution that we understand as the basis of our government today. And something interesting about the 10th Amendment in the Bill of Rights, the 10th Amendment to the Constitution, is it reserved those police powers to the states and then sometimes delegated to local authorities. Of course, tribes have their own sovereignty and can pass public health laws for tribal nations and Indian country, and territories have authority to pass public health laws as well. And at the federal government, the power to pass public health related laws really spring from the authority of the federal government to regulate interstate commerce, because of course diseases can go across state lines and affect commerce if lots of people get sick. And then also we can tax, bring in revenues to the federal government, and then spend those on things that we think are going to help the public's health.
So as you say, we have a distribution of powers, but most public health actions are taken at local and state levels. I think this is something that many of us at CDC have to work with folks to remind them, is that we are not the seat of public health power for the country.
That's right. I think in public health we often talk about the front lines of public health, and indeed, for the most part, the front lines really are state, tribal, local, and territorial health departments out there protecting the health of their populations.
So these powers that are at the state and local level, what do they give states and cities and tribes and territories? What do they give them the authority to do in general?
Well, most states have, coming from the police powers, they have the authority to pass statutes and promulgate regulations, and then sometimes organize their own internal health department policies to protect the public's health. So sometimes these are expressed in ways that we can sort of easily identify. So in public health, we're all familiar with disease reporting and then disease investigation. And in some cases, if there is some health outbreak, some sort of disease outbreak that's going to adversely affect the public's health, we can bring in disease control measures such as isolation and quarantine, or even sometimes just guidance coming from the health department. And of course, the police powers also give rise to things that in types of laws and regulations that might not be immediately identified as something to do with public health. So things like motor vehicle laws, so seatbelt laws and texting bans, and even the organization of how we travel on our roads, stoplights. So these things affect the public's health as well, and most of those stem from the police powers.
Yeah, I think it's important that people understand what that term means, you know, in this public health law context. I think you all did a good job at today's session of pointing that out. You introduced another, I think, important concept today, and that's legal epidemiology. Could you let our audience know what you all mean by that term and why it's important for them to understand?
Yeah, it's a great question, and it's an emerging field in public health practice. I think at the core of this idea of legal epidemiology is the very recent recognition that law really is one of the determinants of health. So we pass laws, again, back to the motor vehicle example, we can pass laws that can affect death and injury on our highways. So people seem to understand the idea that speed limits are kind of a safety issue. And if we have speed limits, say a 25 mile per hour speed limit, the idea is to try to protect the people in the residential area. So laws can definitely affect the health of populations. The idea of legal epidemiology is that we want to study those laws as a factor in sort of the cause of disease and injury, the way that disease and injury are spread around and distributed in our communities. And then also, if you look at something like isolation and quarantine, maybe the way that law can be used to prevent the spread of disease, or maybe prevent disease from occurring in the first place.
If I can paraphrase, studying not just which states have which laws, but how those are related to health behaviors and health outcomes, and hopefully allow us to make conclusions about, you know, what types of laws work better to protect public health. Can you give us just an example of how this concept of legal epidemiology has been applied in recent years?
Sure. So there's really kind of two components to what we try to do. The first question is, what does the law say? So this is the idea of legal mapping. We want to go out and say, well, what jurisdictions have a particular type of law? And then from there, we try to move on to the question, well, how is the law working? Or what is the impact that the law is having? So in the first instance, a good example is during the Ebola outbreak. We were very interested here at CDC what states were doing, were going to do to try to control the potential spread of Ebola in the United States when folks were coming back from having served in the affected countries in Africa. So they started putting out policies. And in the public health law program, we started to track what those policies said. So what do the laws say, and how many states have them? We started to track them and started to compare them to CDC guidance. Are they equivalent to CDC guidance? Are they more stringent? So that when folks came back from Africa, they would understand what the conditions were going to be once they returned home. And interestingly, as we studied those over time and started publishing our results, we saw that states were reacting to what we were saying about their policies. And some states started to change the way that their policies were published so that to say that, no, actually we want them to be equivalent, and so we'll change the language to make it clear that we're equivalent to CDC guidance. And it was a really nice study because it was very compressed in time. The states were passing these policies very quickly in response to CDC guidance. So it's a great example of not only a legal mapping, so what are the states saying about an issue, but also looking at it over time in a type of policy surveillance.
Very interesting example, because it also brings in the idea of trying to compare laws to standards of expert guidance or standards of evidence. Again, we would certainly want our public health laws ultimately, I think, to be both effective, but you know, based on the best scientific evidence and data.
That's exactly right. And of course, once we get into the idea of, you know, how is the law working, then we want to be able to compare it to some sort of external standard, whether it's health data, what are the impact that zoning laws have on violence or the obesity or physical activity, but also it can be guidelines and standards established by public health and medical and science experts around the world.
So you had mentioned earlier that law can be viewed as a social determinant of health. This is a big area of focus for public health right now. What does public health law have to contribute to the coming era in public health where we're trying to not only study but modify those social determinants of health again to result in healthier behaviors and a healthier population?
Yeah, that's a great question. I think it kind of plays out in two different ways. And of course, again, this is an emerging field, and so we're working together to try to figure out exactly what role public health law and legal epidemiology will play in this emerging idea of a new public health system. So first off, I think it's good to recognize, as I said earlier, that law really is by itself a determinant of health. So we can do things like take a promising public health intervention that may be tested or experimented on sort of a small population. And if it works, then we can roll that into statutes, regulations, or department policies and have that intervention affect a larger population. And I think what we're trying to do now is bring a little bit more rigor into the way that we study those laws and the impact that they're having. And in the larger context, when we look at social determinants of health, such as education and transportation and systems like this, that we understand that law really is at the foundation of those systems. So the transportation in the transportation system in the United States really looks and feels and behaves the way it does because it's built upon a system of laws at the federal, state, and local level. And what we need to do is understand what is the impact that the system's having on the public's health, and then start to look at, well, is there a way that we can change the laws in order to change the system to have better health outcomes in the end for our populations?
Yeah, I think transportation is a very good example because we can think of ways that transportation policies infect environmental health through air pollution, how they affect obesity rates through allowing active transportation options, a lot of potential public health implications there. And again, just I guess one way to sort of bring the conversation back to where we started is to remind people that these experiments, if you will, in laws to improve the social determinants of health are going to be played out at the state and local level primarily.
That's right. It's one of the great things about the United States in that we can have this variation across the states and allows us to study sort of differences between the systems and among the systems and really try to figure out in this laboratory of democracy, what are the ways, are there nuances that seem to work better in some areas? Are there nuances that maybe have detrimental impacts to the public health? And then we can study those and try to then reconfigure the laws and the systems in other states to, of course, ultimately, the goal is to have better public health outcomes.
Thank you very much, Matthew. Please join us next month for Beyond the Data.